I'm just going to pick up pretty much where I left off yesterday. If you recall, I had defined this complexity class QMA, and I'm reminding you what this class is. You remember that a problem is in QMA if we have some polynomial time quantum algorithm or a verification procedure that satisfies these two properties, that if you have an input and the answer is yes, then there's some quantum state rho that convinces this algorithm that the answer should be yes with high probability. And in the case that we have a no input, then it doesn't matter what this state is, it will not convince this procedure to believe that x is a yes input, except perhaps with some small probability. I was running out of time toward the end of the lecture yesterday, and so I neglected to say some things that I probably should have said. I think it's pretty clear, but I'll say it anyway, that we don't define a class like this one because we imagine this is somehow a class that captures something that we can actually do with the computer. Of course, you know, here we're talking about the existence of this quantum state, and that may be a very difficult quantum state to prepare, something that you wouldn't find in nature or that perhaps would take you exponential time to prepare, so that for all intents and purposes, it's as if you, you know, couldn't feasibly do this. That isn't the point of this class. The point of this class is to, first of all, understand the notion of verification in the quantum setting, and also to serve as a way of classifying computational problems. And so I had also talked a little bit about this problem, the two local Hamiltonian problem, which is a very natural problem to think about. It's just you're given this Hamiltonian, it's a two local Hamiltonian, and you're interested in whether its ground state energy is small or large. It's a, you know, sort of very, very basic and natural problem to consider, and it turns out that this problem is a complete problem for QMA. And one way you can think about this is to say that, you know, QMA in some way perfectly captures the difficulty of this problem. If you wanted to, you could have defined QMA by starting with this problem and then talked about all the problems that can be reduced to this problem by a classical polynomial time reduction. You would arrive at an equivalent definition. So that's where I left off, and what I want to do now is I want to give you an example of something that you can do with a quantum proof to give you some sense for how you could use this this ability. And so this example is going to be concerned with computations in finite groups. And it's okay if you're not really so familiar with group theory, but if you are, it's more, you know, it's helpful. So in a moment, if you're not familiar with group theory, I'll kind of let you off the hook, but just for the moment, let's assume that you have some familiarity with this notion. So let's imagine that we have some group G, and it's going to be a finite group, and we have some way of writing down the elements in that group as binary strings, and we assume that a single group element never has more than one string that represents it. So you may have lots of strings that don't represent group elements, that's fine, but if you have a particular element in this group, there's just a unique way of writing it down as a string. And we're going to assume that we have efficient computations in this group in the following sense. If we have two group elements, G and H, then we have some way of multiplying them together. And here I've written this as a reversible operation because I want to be able to use this as a unitary operation in a computation. So you start with G and H, and if you leave G sitting in the first register and you just sort of multiply G into the second register from the left, then you'll get some reversible operation, and we're making the assumption that this operation can be performed efficiently. And similarly, if we have an element and we wish to compute the inverse, we can simply replace G by G inverse. So for many finite groups that you would think about, these are easily implemented things. For example, you might think about the group of permutations of some number of symbols, and we can write these things down in many different ways and we can do these operations efficiently. Another example, which I think is a helpful example to think about to sort of get a sense for the computational difficulties of working in this setting, is the following thing. We can think of G as being a collection of n by n matrices for some value of n, and imagine that all of the entries in the matrices are between 0 and p minus 1 for some prime number p. And every time we do any arithmetic, we'll always just take it modulo p. So there's a finite number of matrices in total. And we're going to restrict our attention to those that are invertible. So if we do this, then we get a finite group. It's called the general linear group for this particular prime. And it's very complicated, right? If you have two group elements, say G and H, and you multiply them together, you get some new matrix. And that may be different than what you get if you multiply H times G. The order matters. This is a non-commutative group. It's a very complicated group. And you can imagine that, for example, somebody would give you, oh, let's say some value of n, like 100, and some value of p, so maybe it's a small number p, maybe it's 3 or 7 or something like that, and then gave you a bunch of matrices and asked you some basic questions like, you know, how many elements can you reach by multiplying these matrices together? That would be a difficult computational problem because it's just a very complicated group. But in any case, for such a group, it would be very easy to implement these things. Of course, we can do matrix multiplication. We can take inverses of matrices. So that's kind of a way of thinking about it if you're not really very comfortable with this notion of a group. Everything I'm going to say can be abstracted, and we don't really even need to have a concrete way of representing these things. We can work in this setting of so-called black box groups where we're really just kind of ignoring all the specifics of the group, and we're just imagining we have a bunch of strings that represent elements, and we have, you know, these transformations that are available to us, but when we look at the representation of some group element, we don't know anything at all about it. It's just a string. So here's an example of a problem that you can consider in this setting, the group membership problem. So here we're just imagining that this group G is always fixed. It's just some big group that we're working in, and if you like, you can think about this general linear group. And the typical way that you think about somebody describing, say, a subgroup of that group in this setting is that they give you a bunch of generators. So let's imagine that somebody gives you a bunch of generators, G1 through GK, they're just elements in this group, along with some other element H, which is the element that you're interested in. What this problem asks is, you know, is it the case that this element H is in the subgroup that's generated by G1 through GK? So this is the notation here. When we put brackets around these guys, we mean the subgroup that you get by taking these generators. In other words, all the elements that you can get by taking any number of guys from this list any number of times, multiplying them together in any order. You'll always get some group by doing this, some subgroup of G, and that's the group that's described by these generators. So the question is very simple. Is H in that subgroup or is it not in that subgroup? Well, this problem happens to be a problem in NP, just to sort of put it in perspective in terms of the things I talked about yesterday. That's actually not so trivial to see. If you're given some H and G1 through GK, and you want to prove to somebody that, let's say somebody gives you these things, and you would like to prove to them that G1 or that H can be generated from G1 through GK, the right way to do it is not to simply write down a list of the elements you multiply together to give you H, because that could be, in some cases, an exponentially long list of things that you have to multiply together to arrive at H. But there is this this theorem of Babai and Zemmeretti. It's called the reachability lemma. And what it says is that you can always, if you have a bunch of elements G1 through GK and you can generate H from them, then you can always write down a short so-called straight line program. It's a program that has no loops, and each line in that program is basically just an element. You start out with the generators, and then any element in that list can be either an inverse of a previous guy or a product of two previous guys. So if you do that, then you can have a fairly short list, and by doing some operations like repeated squaring and so on, you can arrive at very, very high powers of elements in a short amount of time. So it's always possible, if H is generated from these guys, to write down a short straight line program that will get you there. So that's enough to show that this problem is in NP, because you can just give somebody a straight line program that generates H from G1 through GK. Okay, so let's imagine now that we do something similar to what we did yesterday when we talked about graph isomorphism. We just reverse the yes and no inputs. So let's consider this problem, the group non-membership problem, which is the same as the one on the previous slide, except I've just exchanged the yes and the no cases. So you're given generators G1 through GK along with some element H, and the yes answers are the ones for which H is not contained in this subgroup. And the no case is when H isn't contained in this subgroup. And you may consider whether or not this problem is in NP. In other words, suppose that I have some particular elements, and I would like to prove to you that, in fact, H is not generated by G1 through GK. So this has some similarity to the graph non-isomorphism problem. In the case of the graph isomorphism problem, it was very easy to write down an isomorphism. And in this case, well, it's not quite so easy, but you just write down one of these straight line programs. And now you can think about this other case. You want to convince somebody that H is not generated by G1 through GK. So how do you do this? Well, much like the graph non-isomorphism problem, this problem is not known to be in NP or in MA, for that matter. And it goes a little bit further than what we had for graph non-isomorphism, in that you can come up with these so-called group oracles, these, you know, groups in this black box group setting, for which you can prove that the problem is not in NP or in MA, sort of along the same lines as these a query model or black box algorithm lower bounds that you heard about earlier in the week. So it seems to be difficult, classically speaking, to write down a proof that some particular element cannot be generated from a bunch of other elements. However, this problem is in the class QMA. So here we see the power that you can derive from a quantum proof and a quantum verification of a proof. And it's actually very, very simple how it works. If we have some particular bunch of generators, G1 through GK, well, let's just, for convenience, from now on, we're going to let capital H be the subgroup that's generated by these guys. We would like to write down a proof that some little h is not in this subgroup H. And that proof is going to be this state here. And the state is simply a uniform superposition over all the elements that are in this subgroup H. So in fact, this is completely independent of the guy that we're interested in. It's just sort of a universal proof that works for that subgroup H, for any element that you want to test, whether it's a member or not. Okay, so let's think about how this works. I should mention that, as you might expect, if you have some group, and particularly when it's a non-abelian group, one of these complicated groups like these matrix groups, it's probably very, very hard to create this state. Nobody here is, you know, we're not talking about how difficult it is or how easy it is to create that state. It might be very challenging. If it's an abelian group, you can create this state. Using, I guess, extensions of Shor's algorithm. But in the non-abelian case, it seems to be very hard. So let's imagine for the moment that somebody actually gave you this state, and you trusted that that was the state that you were given. So the question is, how do you use this state to test membership in this subgroup H? Well, we can run an algorithm that looks like this, and this algorithm looks very similar to phase estimation or eigenvalue estimation algorithm that you would have seen earlier in the week. So here's the algorithm, and just to make sure that it's understandable, let me first mention that this big gate in the middle, or this big operation in the middle, this is a controlled multiply by H operation. So this is a typical notation that people would use for such a thing when we have some operation and it is controlled by some qubit up here. So the way it works is that if you have a zero sitting in this top qubit here, nothing at all happens. It's just like, you know, an ordinary controlled gate. You just don't do anything because the control is not on. If the control is on or set to one, then what happens is that this guy just multiplies H into whatever is sitting in this bunch of qubits here. And it, specifically, it does this coming from the left. So you replace A by H times A. And because we're working in the setting of a finite group, this is a reversible operation. And so you can talk about having building a quantum circuit that does this. And if you have the assumptions that I talked about before, which is that you can do the efficiently implement the group operations, multiplication and inversion, then you can build a thing that looks like this, and that's not too hard. Okay, so is the algorithm clear? I haven't explained why it should work, but just to make sure that the notation and picture is clear. Okay, let's consider first the case where we have a no input. And so remember, we're talking about the group non-membership problem. So a no input means that H is an element of capital H. So we have our algorithm from before, and we run it, and we think about what happens. We're working under the assumption that little h is in the subgroup H. And so if you think about what happens with this multiply by H operation, well, you had this superposition over all these guys in H, and you multiply by little h, and now everything is just going to be sort of shifted like this. So this notation should be self-explanatory. I just mean the uniform superposition over this coset are all the elements that can be written as the product little h times something in big H. But little h is contained in big H, so this is actually doing nothing at all. It's just kind of stirring the elements around, but they were all already stirred up to begin with, so it's doing absolutely nothing. It's just essentially applying the identity to this thing, because H was contained in H, so by multiplying it, you're just moving the elements around, but it was a uniform superposition to begin with. So this controlled multiplication operation, it has no effect at all on this particular state. It's as if you didn't do it. So you started out with a zero, you do the Hadamard transform, you do nothing at all, and then you do the Hadamard transform again. Naturally, when you measure here, and you measure in the standard basis, I should have mentioned that, but that's the assumption here, of course you're going to see a zero, because it's just as if you had a zero qubit and you did the Hadamard transform twice. So you always see zero with 100% chance. We're not worried about errors here. Of course, if there's errors or inaccuracies, they may creep in, but in the idealized case, you measure and you see zero. Now we can ask what happens in the yes case. And remember, the yes case here is where H is not an element of big H. So that's our algorithm. Well, we have the same kind of calculation as before, but now we have that little h is not in big H. So you multiply by H, and you're going to get this uniform superposition over this coset. And this thing is actually going to be orthogonal to the state you started with. And this is just a basic fact from group theory, which is that if you have elements in a coset, you'll never have any intersection with the original subgroup unless these two guys were equal. But we know that's not the case. So this multiply by H operation is actually just completely shifting everything, and the two states have orthogonal support. So they're orthogonal. And so what that means is this controlled multiply by H operation is really just like a measurement of this qubit here. It's a measurement that's a measurement in sort of a complicated way. Written down here is some superposition of a bunch of group elements. And if you looked at it, you would see a group element. And you can think of that as an encoding of a 0 or a 1, an encoding in a very complicated way that's difficult for a person to extract in a computational sense. But information, theoretically, all the information is there. So it's working just like a measurement. So you started out with a zero, you did a Hadamard transform, you did something that looks like a measurement in the standard basis. So if you now just imagine throwing this thing in the trash, you forgot what the result was, you'll have a completely mixed state here. You do Hadamard transform, you still have a completely mixed state, and you measure. And so you'll see a zero half the time, and you'll see a one half the time. And that's enough statistical evidence for you to conclude whether or not H is in big H or not. You can just do this a couple of times. If you want to, you can ask for multiple copies of the proof. Or even if you want to, you can imagine sort of reusing the state that comes out. It turns out that works pretty well. And that'll tell you whether or not you have an element, whether H is an element. So if you ever see the outcome 1 here, at that point you're certain. It must have been that little h was not contained in H, and you're convinced. So that's very simple. There's a problem, of course. The problem is that you couldn't actually trust that you were given the right state. Remember that you have to have this soundness property that says it doesn't matter how devious somebody is, if they come up with some quantum state and feed it into your verification procedure, it shouldn't convince this thing to say yes when the answer is no. And we can't trust that somebody's going to be nice enough to give us this as our state. They just give us some arbitrary state. They're playing adversary to our verification procedure. Well, if you take an arbitrary state and you plug it into this procedure, well, pretty much anything is possible. There's nothing much to say about that. So we have to do a little bit of work to figure out how to get around this problem. And one solution is as follows. We're going to do the same thing we did before, except instead of doing this membership test with H, we're going to run the test with random choices of elements that we know to be in H. Let's call them A1 through AK. And this is not the same K as the number of generators. I just reused the letter K. So imagine doing this membership test with a bunch of random elements. And they're going to have to be sort of random in a particular sense, that we want to have certain properties of this distribution. But we can ignore that for now and just think of them as being random. So imagine you run this membership test and you do it with a random element of H. Well, the thing better say, you better get an outcome zero, because you know the answer. The answer was it's not an element, or excuse me, that it is an element. The first case from before said that the outcome is always supposed to be zero. So if you ever saw a one, you know that, somebody gave you a bad proof, and you just say, the answer is no, I don't believe you, and you walk away. Because you're not responsible if somebody gives you a bad proof. You're only checking the quality of the proof. So your answer is only as good as the quality of the proof. So if you ever see one of these things gives you the answer, the outcome one, you know that it was bad, you just say no and you forget it. Otherwise, you continue, and then eventually you do the membership test H, but you do it on the state that comes out here. Every time you run this thing, you always just take the state that comes out here as the next proof going into the next verification. And essentially what you're doing is, by going through this thing and making these measurements, you're either saying, okay, this is a bad proof and I walk away, or in some sense you're improving the quality of the proof as time goes on. And it's becoming more and more suitable for testing. So to see this, we can imagine what happens if we run our algorithm on whatever state we have. Here we've picked some A that was an A that we already knew was an H. And now let's imagine we condition on seeing the outcome zero. So if we see the outcome one, it's over. We see the outcome zero, we can ask, what is the state that comes out here? And, well, up to some normalization, it turns out that the state is going to look like that, and that's a simple calculation to see. And now you imagine you repeat this with these guys, and here's where you use the fact that these were sort of very well chosen, suitably random elements in this group. You're going to end up with this kind of thing normalized at the end of the day. If you've chosen these elements well, it'll be normalized. Well, this thing may not necessarily be the original state that we wanted, a superposition over all LH, but it's just as good, because this thing is now invariant under multiplication on the left by elements of H. So if you run the membership test with your guy and you see that you get non-member, then you know you can trust it. And you say, yes, I believe the answer is yes. Otherwise, you say no. So that's how it works. You have a question? The value of K. Okay, so that's a good question. So technically what you should do is you should take these A1 through AK to be so-called cube generators of the group, which are a bunch of elements, so that if you imagine taking these things in order and you take exponents 0 or 1 uniformly, then you should get something that is close to being uniform over the whole group, and you need to sort of refer to some theorem from computational group theory that tells you what is the right value of K to choose and how do you obtain these elements. And it's highly non-trivial. And I don't know what the value of K is off the top of my head. Of course, it can't be any less than the logarithm of the size of the group. But, I'm going to be on video. I'm going to be on YouTube. I don't want to say something that's wrong, so I won't try to guess. But you can look that up. And if it's not linear, I'm sure it's quadratic at worst. But, I probably just made my blunder for the lecture. But that's something that can be looked up. Okay, so that's the end of the discussion on QMA. I'm going to continue to something new now, sort of an extension of this idea, which is a notion of an interactive proof system. I can pause here for any questions if there are any. It's independent of the H, not the G1 through GK.
Yeah, so, I mean, it could be like easy compared to QPP by embedding this state with the algorithm, right? I mean,
okay, so if you, now, you would be changing your problem, right? Because your problem takes as input not just H, but G1 through GK. If you want to think of a new problem where G1 through GK is somehow, you know, fixed, put into the description of the problem, and your input is just simply this H, then yes, now it doesn't necessarily need to be a proof anymore. I guess you've sort of moved into this notion of quantum advice, where you can imagine having a quantum state that's given to you, and you don't care about the difficulty of constructing it, but it's just part of it's like the initialization of your machine. So you can do that, but you have to change the problem and not let G1 through GK be part of the input anymore. Okay, what time am I supposed to stop, by the way?
So
I have like 30 minutes, okay. Yeah, less than 25 minutes. Yeah, okay. Okay, so... okay, yeah, roughly, okay. So for most of the rest of the talk, I'll be talking about the interactive proof system model, and this is an interesting way of generalizing the notion of a proof and thinking about this issue of verification of proofs. So I'll start by talking about it in the classical case, and then I'll talk about the quantum case. So in this setting, things work in a very similar way to what you have for NP or MA or QMA, where you are thinking about the verification of some input being a yes input of some problem. But now we're replacing the proof, which was a string before, or a quantum state, with some entity that can be asked questions and answer questions. So the two entities that we have in this model are the verifier, and this verifier is always computationally bounded, and you can think of this as being very much like we had in QMA. It's just the verification procedure, or NP or MA. And now we also have this prover. The prover is not subject to any computational restrictions. We don't worry about the complexity of the operations performed by the prover because we're trying to focus on this issue of verification. Of course, this prover is restricted to obey the laws of physics. He can't go back in time. He can't peek into the private memory of the verifier, things like that. They both receive an input string X, and then they have a conversation. The verifier can ask questions, the prover can give answers. Everything has to be short enough that the verifier has time to examine everything. The verifier has to run in time polynomial in the input length. That's the typical assumption. So this has to be a relatively short conversation. And eventually, when it's done, the verifier will output his answer, 0 or 1, and it's the same as before. He's either rejecting or accepting the prover's argument, and the prover is trying to argue that the answer to the input problem is yes. So it's really analogous to the cases we already saw, but now there's an interaction. So if we say that our particular problem has an interactive proof system, we mean that we have two conditions that are very, very similar to what we had before. Same intuitive meaning. The completeness condition says that if you have an input string and it's a yes input, then there must be something the prover can do that will cause this verifier to say, I believe you, at least with high probability. And I'm starting to become sloppy now and say just high probability instead of probability 2/3 or whatever, because these notions are all very robust with respect to how you choose your error bounds. If you like, you can substitute 2/3, but intuitively it's just high probability. Soundness condition says that if you have a no input, then it doesn't matter what this prover does. He's never going to convince this verifier to say yes, except perhaps with some small probability. So here's an example that gives you an intuitive feel for where you might get some extra power from this model. You can think about what you could possibly prove with a string, and you can think about what could possibly be proved through an interaction. And this is not a computational problem, it's just a silly example, but it gives you a sense for how this works. And so in this example, I ask you to consider the following claim, which is that Coke and Pepsi taste different. And so whenever I give this example, I always ask how many people can taste the difference between Coke and Pepsi. Okay, so some. Okay, so everyone who raised your hand, you imagine you're the prover in this setting. And for those of you who don't know the difference between the taste of Coke and Pepsi, you can think of yourself as the verifier. You're the sort of skeptic. You're not ready to believe this. Maybe a lot of you that didn't raise your hand, you don't drink soda. That could be the case. But in any case, just imagine this. I also have to ask every time I give the example, like if is Pepsi still alive? Is it still around? I mean, did Coke win? Or I don't even know. So, okay. So anyway, this is kind of based on this advertising campaign from a long time ago, the so-called Pepsi Challenge, where they would ask people to taste Coke and Pepsi and see which tasted better. And statistically, people preferred Pepsi by some small margin, which I think was enough to make the advertising campaign successful. But anyway, so let's suppose that you believe the claim and that indeed you can taste the difference. And if you want to imagine that you're playing the role of the prover, but you can't taste the difference between Coke and Pepsi, you can think about salt and sugar. I think everybody can taste the difference between salt and sugar. How would you convince a skeptic of this fact, that these things taste different? Well, you're never going to write down a non-interactive proof, a standard, a traditional notion of a proof that you can hand them a piece of paper and they're going to read it and they're going to believe that Coke and Pepsi taste different for any number of reasons, right? I mean, I don't know what such a proof would look like. Let's say, of course you can't write down such a proof. You can't get the formula for Coke. Maybe we haven't studied enough biochemistry to be able to understand that proof anyway. I don't know what it would look like, but it's pretty much impossible. But nevertheless, if you want to convince somebody that Coke and Pepsi taste different, you can do it. It's easy to do it. You just allow them to perform a blind taste test on you, right? You, imagining that you can taste the difference between Coke and Pepsi, you put on a blindfold. You ask a skeptic to randomly choose Coke or Pepsi, put it into a glass, and you taste it, and you identify which one it was. The first one, okay, was Coke. Second one, Pepsi. Third one, Pepsi. And you do this 100 times. If you can taste the difference between Coke and Pepsi, you're correct every time. If you couldn't really taste the difference between Coke and Pepsi because they didn't taste different, then you'd have to be randomly guessing every time. Okay, imagine in an idealized setting where you're not gathering any information, you can't smell the difference between Coke or Pepsi or feel the difference in the bubbles on your face or something like that. It's just an idealized setting. Well, imagine you were able to identify the correct beverage 100 times in a row. Well, the skeptic should be convinced by this point. Of course, there is a very small chance that you just randomly guessed and you managed to guess the correct one every single time. But that's like flipping a coin 100 times in a row, getting heads every single time. That doesn't happen. I mean, it could in principle, but it doesn't. So in this setting, we're thinking of proofs in perhaps more of a cryptographic sense, where you're willing to accept this minuscule probability, like 2 to the minus 100, that you're being tricked. And that may be perfectly acceptable in a cryptographic setting. It's not meant to be sort of a direct analog of a formal mathematical notion of a proof, where you probably wouldn't be very happy about having the small probability of proving a theorem that was false. Well, there's a similar protocol for the graph non-isomorphism problem. It's our example that we keep going back to over and over. So here's the problem again, which I've written down, but you've seen it a couple of times already. So I told you that nobody knows how to show that this problem is in NP. Nobody knows how to write down a short proof that two graphs are not isomorphic. But in fact, there is an interactive proof system that's very simple, and it's really almost the same thing as the Coke and Pepsi example. So just to make sure we keep things straight, the prover and the verifier are both receiving a pair of graphs. The prover is trying to prove to the verifier that the graphs are not isomorphic. And now we're trying to come up with a way that the verifier can be convinced. So the verifier is going to do a blind taste test on the prover. The verifier randomly chooses a bit, 0 or 1, and he's going to pick graph number B, either G0 or G1, and apply some random permutation to it. He chooses this permutation randomly, let H be the resulting graph, and send H to the prover. And now implicitly, the prover is being challenged to taste the difference between the two graphs. He's supposed to answer which graph was used to derive this random graph H. If G0 and G1 are isomorphic, then there's absolutely no difference in the distribution. If the permutation was chosen randomly, you get precisely the same distribution. It's just a uniform distribution over all the graphs that are isomorphic to the two of them. Isomorphism is an equivalence relation. It has to be just a single equivalence class. All the graphs that are isomorphic to either or both, it's the same thing. But of course, if the graphs are not isomorphic, then the two distributions are disjoint, because you won't have any permutations that agree, because otherwise the graphs would be isomorphic. So the prover is all-powerful, computationally speaking. He can solve the problem, just figure out which one was given. And he identifies which one it was. They do this 100 times in a row. Or they can even do it 100 times in parallel. The verifier can just pick all the graphs at once, send them all, and ask for the answers all at once. So you really only need one question and one response. Or a very long question and a very long response. But you can do this, and you can have extremely small probability of making an error. So it's really just the same idea as the blind taste test that shows you that this problem has an interactive proof system. Well, there's a couple of complexity classes that we can define. We're still in the classical setting. Here's two basic ones. I should mention that there's a lot of variants of this model that people have thought about, and you can define complexity classes by limiting the resources of either the verifier or both the prover and the verifier. You can talk about verifiers that are bounded in time, bounded in space. You can put some computational restrictions on the prover. You can add assumptions about privacy and lots of different things. But the two classes that I want to mention that are maybe the most basic ones, the first one is called AM, and again, it stands for Arthur Merlin. Before we had Merlin Arthur, it's just an example of a class that's in this family of Arthur Merlin games. So these are all the promise problems that have interactive proof systems, where you have a constant number of messages. For example, this graph non-isomorphism example I just gave you has two messages, a question and a response. So that's enough to tell you that the graph non-isomorphism problem is in this class AM. And AM contains a lot of interesting problems, including the group non-membership problem and many others. If we drop this restriction of saying that there has to be a constant number of messages, then we get this class called IP for interactive proofs. These are just the names that were picked a long time ago, and it's kind of stuck. These are the promise problems that have classical interactive proof systems. You can have any number of messages you want. Of course, it has to be a polynomial number because the verifier isn't allowed to run for more than polynomial time, so he wouldn't have time to examine all the messages if there was more. Well, a great result from 1990 says that, in fact, IP is equal to p-space. So here we have an example, which is kind of, well, certainly not uncommon in complexity theory, which is that you can define complexity classes based in totally different models in completely different ways, and a lot of times you have these things coinciding perfectly. So these two classes turn out to be exactly the same, just two different ways of characterizing the same fundamental collection of problems. That's a complicated proof. One direction is easy. It's easy to show that IP is contained in P space. If you have an interactive proof system for some problem, you can simulate that in a polynomial amount of space, which looks sort of like some kind of traversal of a game tree. But you can do this without using very much space. The other direction to show that every problem in P space is this enormous collection of problems. Is contained in IP, it's much more complicated. I hinted at this on a previous slide, but both of these classes are very robust with respect to the way you choose your error bounds, you know, whether it's two-thirds or something exponentially close to one, and you can even make the probability be equal to one in the completeness condition. These classes really don't care how you choose your error bounds. So you're going to get the same class no matter what, as long as it's bounded error. So here is our diagram now, continuing to add classes. So we've added AM, which is over here. It contains MA, that's a triviality. And beyond that, nothing much is really known. For example, it's not known if AM is, you know, contains QMA. The relationship between AM and PP is not known. But we get this containment in P space, and we have IP being equal to P space. So these are the way these classes fit into our picture. So I'm going to move to the quantum case soon, but I wanted to very quickly give you some historical motivation for thinking about these things. I imagine that well, some of you are computer scientists, and maybe some of you are theorists. Many of you are physicists, and you know, interested in perhaps more practical things, and you wonder why people would care about such classes like this. And we talk about provers, and we don't find these things in nature. And this is some motivation that comes from the classical setting that I think is helpful to see that, in some way, when we talk about these things, you know, we are talking about fundamental notions, notions of proof and verification, and interaction, and things that are natural in a cryptographic setting. And sometimes when you, as a theorist, basically follow your nose and think about things that you just find interesting and fundamental for whatever reason, unexpected applications will come. And there were some pretty spectacular applications of thinking about these models in the classical setting. So it starts with the notion of NP completeness, which was first devised in the 70s by Cook, Karp, and Levin. I don't know if it's necessary for me to motivate the notion of NP completeness, but in case it is, I should just say that this is, you know, one of the, you know, certainly the greatest export of complexity theory to the rest of the world. Every area of science that has computational problems makes use of this notion of NP completeness. You find NP complete problems in, of course, physics, chemistry, biology, just about any science you think about. And if you do a search on Google Scholar for the term NP complete in the abstract of papers, you will get enormous numbers of hits. It's a very important notion that, you know, it tells you about computational difficulty in a very fundamental and important way. Well, this very naturally leads to a notion of approximation problems. We have all these problems that we care about. People from economics and different sciences and so on, they have these computational problems. They wish they could solve them. They turn out to be NP complete, so they give up on finding an efficient algorithm, hopefully. But they still want to solve the problem. So you can think about this notion of an approximation problem. Say, okay, I know I can't be perfect, but I still want to solve my problem. Can I get an approximate solution? You know, I still need to plan my flights, or I still need to pack the chips onto the circuit. What do I do? So there's this notion of approximation problems, and now you can talk about the difficulty of approximation problems. And for many years, there were these fundamentally difficult questions about how do you talk about hardness of approximation, and there were big mysteries about that, and people didn't really know how to get a handle on that. So that's this notion of hardness of approximation that was sort of a mystery. And it's very, you know, very practical problem. Independent of that, people thought about interactive proofs. These were first published in 1985. And shortly after that, people came up with this model of multi-prover interactive proofs, and I may touch on that in the end if I have time, but it's just a variant where you have multiple provers that can't communicate. And then this great result came around in 1990, IP equals P space. And the techniques that were used to prove that were very interesting techniques. They led very quickly to a proof that MIP, the problems that have multi-prover interactive proofs, gives you exactly this enormous class of problems, non-deterministic exponential time. People took the techniques that were used there, they scaled them down to arrive at this result that's called the PCP theorem, which is one of the most fundamental and important theorems in modern computational complexity. And then it was noticed that all of a sudden this PCP theorem provided the key to understanding this notion of hardness of approximation. And all of a sudden, all of these problems that were not known to be, these approximation problems that weren't very well understood, could be proved to be hard. And of course, there were limitations. And as a result of this, there's very healthy interplay between deriving approximation algorithms and coming up with hardness of approximation results that led people to be able to really sort of focus in on thresholds where problems became hard and after which they became easy and so on. So here we have this setting where, you know, people thought about these kind of abstract models just for their intrinsic interest, and for whatever reason, they came around and led to this very important practical result. I should mention that not too long ago, Irit and Ur came up with a combinatorial proof of this theorem that sort of just circumvented all of this stuff. And that's a great result and was very much appreciated. But nevertheless, we wouldn't necessarily have come up with the theorem in the first place without thinking about these fundamental models. So hopefully that's some motivation for why we might think about such things. Okay, so now let me tell you about the quantum version of these interactive proof system models. And I don't really need to spend very much time, I think, because all of the notions are basically the same. All we do is we just change a couple of assumptions. One is that the verifier and now the prover, instead of being classical, now they're quantum, naturally. They can do quantum computations. The verifier will be limited to polynomial time quantum computations, or in other words, computations that can be done with circuit families that are uniformly generated, polynomial size. The prover will perform quantum computations, but he won't be restricted. And they can send quantum messages back and forth. And so if you want to formalize this model in terms of the circuit model, you can imagine a picture that sort of looks like this. So each one of these boxes here represents a channel or a quantum computation that's just taking some input that could be classical or quantum and then producing some output, and they send messages back and forth. They can each have their sort of private memory that they use as part of this protocol. And then at the end of the day, the verifier will output a single bit, make a measurement, and you take this as being the answer, the decision that the verifier has made. Okay, so we define various classes based on this model, and here are two, or I should say a family of them. The first one is QIP, and you can think of this as being analogous to IP. It's just the problems that have quantum interactive proofs. We don't put any restrictions on the number of messages or anything like that. It's just kind of the standard class you would define from the definition of the model. We can also do something similar to what we had in the classical case where we restricted to a constant number of messages. And just to be a little bit more precise about it, let's imagine that we restrict the number of messages to be m for some value of m. Let's say m is a positive integer. Then we get this class. All the problems that have quantum interactive proofs where at most m messages are exchanged in total. I didn't mention when I talked about the classical case, this class AM, we can define this as all the problems where we have constant message classical interactive proofs is a basic result about this model, which is that anytime you have that situation, you may as well substitute your proof system for one that has exactly two messages. You can always collapse down to two messages in the classical case, just like what happened in the graph isomorphism case. Okay. Well, it turns out that this is the relationship that holds, one relationship that holds between these things. So QIP3, if you have three messages, already you get all the power of QIP. And it turns out that that's equal to P space. So just if you take a look at this equation for a moment, what it means is that we already knew that IP equals P space. We put a Q in front of this. And that means when you give a quantum power to this model, in fact, you don't get any new problems at all. It has the same power as the classical model. So I don't know if that's unexpected or not. You might expect the quantum model to be more powerful, but that doesn't happen here. And maybe what's responsible for that is that the power of the interaction is so huge that in a way it's kind of washing out the difference between the quantum and the classical models. One advantage you do get from the quantum setting, though, is that once you have three messages, you already have all the power of any number of messages, including a polynomial number of messages. That's something that's probably not true in a classical case. We probably have P space and AM being different. These complicated protocols for general P space problems, well, it can't be proved. Nobody's proved it, but it would seem likely that you need a polynomial number of messages that go back and forth. But that doesn't happen here. So quantum interactive proofs are no more powerful than classical, but you can get a significant reduction in the number of messages that you need. So here's our diagram now. So we have P space, which is equal to QIP here. QIP1, of course, if there's just one message, it's really the same thing as QMA, rather. Just one message from the prover to the verifier, it's just like a quantum proof. So there's no difference in those two models. It's just a trivial fact, nothing more than just interpreting the definition. QIP2, the class you get when you have two messages, it's a bit of a mystery. It's known to be, contained everywhere that you get a containment from basically just a trivial argument, but not much more than this kind of trivial containment results are known. I want to mention how you prove something about how you prove these upper bounds on QIP. So remember when I mentioned that IP is contained in P space, and I said this is an easy result. If you have a problem and it has an interactive proof, you can show that that problem is in P space, and you basically just do this, you know, relatively straightforward traversal of a game tree, type of game tree that you would get from looking at a proof system, you know, messages back and forth. In the quantum setting, it becomes much more complicated than that, because you don't have a tree like this anymore. These are quantum states, there's entanglement, and it just doesn't give the same representation. But you can prove these bounds using the technique of semi-definite programming. And I don't know if semi-definite programming has made any appearances earlier in the week, but this is a technique from, I guess, combinatorial optimization and combinatorial algorithms, optimization theory, that turns out to have many, many interesting applications in quantum information. So if you haven't started seeing this term used, you will, because it comes up quite a lot. It's a very powerful tool. And I don't have enough time, of course, to tell you very much about it, but if you do know something about it, then I can give you some hint as to how you use this technique to prove bounds on the power of quantum interactive proofs. So here we have our kind of interaction from before, where each of these wires here, it's really now a bunch of qubits. I just didn't want to draw lots of lines. So think of this as some large number of qubits, some polynomial number of qubits going back and forth. I've attached a name to each of these things, thinking of this as a Hilbert space that corresponds to that bunch of qubits. And we can think about taking the reduced states, these are density operators, on these systems that are the systems that the verifier is touching at these various points in time as this protocol goes on. So these are density operators involving some polynomial number of qubits. And if you think about it for a little while, use some basic facts from quantum information theory, you can prove that by running such a proof system, it's very easy to characterize exactly what states could possibly appear over all possible courses of action for this prover. And they're given by these pretty simple constraints down here. They may not look simple when you look at them for 30 seconds, but these are pretty simple things here. So this condition here is just saying, well, the first state is what you defined it to be. It's just whatever came out of this verifier. There's no choices here. These subsequent states, they can depend upon the actions of the prover, and this is kind of the variable in a sense. You don't know what the prover is doing. But you have to have some pretty simple conditions, like if you just look at the reduced state of the verifier's memory, this guy has to be equal to this guy because the prover didn't touch that part, and likewise for all of them. That's what this row here characterizes, and this row here just characterizes something very simple, which is that this guy maps to this guy by this transformation and so on. It's very simple consistency conditions. And these, of course, they have to be density operators. They have to be positive semi-definite and trace equal to 1. The trace equals 1 condition is already enforced by this guy here. And here, this is just a maximization over all the possible, maximizing the probability of getting an outcome 1. So it's just this optimization problem, and you're optimizing over a bunch of matrices. And this is an example of one of these semi-definite programs. And we can use algorithms that are known for semi-definite programs. This is an exponential-sized semi-definite program. But nevertheless, you can use those techniques to give algorithms. That shows you that QIP is contained in deterministic exponential time. It's a pretty easy proof. It's kind of like an over-the-counter remedy for your problem. You just kind of go and you use these well-known algorithms for solving semi-definite programs. If you want to go down to P-space, you have to work a little bit harder. And I'm running out of time, so I'll just very quickly flash up the sort of bottom line, which is that if you want to get QIP in P-space, you need not only an efficient algorithm for solving semi-definite programs, but you need a parallel algorithm for solving semi-definite programs. The connection between a parallel algorithm and a polynomial space algorithm is something that goes back to 1970s. I mean, if we imagined we had an algorithm here that would start with our input. It would sort of stretch it out into a big semi-definite program description, exponential in size. And then we had an algorithm that could solve that, and this would be a massively parallel algorithm so that the entire depth here would be polynomial in the length here. It could be an exponential size computation, but the depth would be polynomial. Then now you have a piece-based algorithm. You just sort of do the most obvious kind of recursive traversal of this circuit. And if you imagine doing that, you would not need more than a polynomial number of bits on your stack at any one time, and that would give you a piece-based algorithm. Well, it turns out to be a little bit challenging to come up with a parallel algorithm. There probably isn't a general parallel algorithm for solving semi-definite programs. But for the special ones you get from quantum interactive proofs, you can do that. Okay, so it's I think, good timing. I have only a couple minutes left, and I want to just mention that I certainly haven't done justice to many topics in quantum complexity theory. I just picked some that were my favorite ones, I guess. And I just wanted to mention that there's many other topics that people think about in quantum complexity. And here are some examples. Quantum query complexity, which you heard something about earlier in the week. I mean, it can certainly be characterized as complexity theory. Communication complexity, likewise. And I also talked about Hamiltonian complexity, which is a very interesting and active area of research. There's a connection to this theorem, this PCP theorem that I mentioned. People are interested in finding a quantum version of this theorem, and this is turning out to be a very difficult thing, and there's a lot of interest in that. There's a lot of other variants of these interactive models. There's this notion of quantum advice that I mentioned in response to a question, where you imagine that you have a quantum algorithm, but you're allowed to initialize the state of your algorithm into some very helpful state that may have been very difficult to prepare, but you can ask how much power this will give you. There was some relationship we knew between BQP and other complexity classes, but there's this interesting complexity class or collection of classes called the polynomial time hierarchy, which I won't define, but it's sort of a fundamental basic structure in complexity theory. And the relationship between BQP and this collection of classes is a big mystery. People have been working on it for many years, and it seems to be very difficult. There's a lot of interest in the complexity theoretic aspects of limited models of quantum computation, such as models based on linear optics. There's a model called the one clean qubit model motivated by NMR, where you imagine you can have a quantum algorithm, but unfortunately only one of your qubits starts out in a pure state and the rest of them are mixed, totally mixed, and you want to know if you can still do anything interesting with that model. And you can think about bounded depth circuits, parallel versions of quantum classes, space-bounded quantum complexity classes. And really, if you want to, you can sort of just go through the catalog of things that people have thought about in classical setting and consider the quantum version. It won't always be interesting. Sometimes it will be boring. I suppose to some extent people should resist just defining a new quantum model because it's there and proving something trivial about it. Usually we're interested in identifying something interesting. But nevertheless, it is possible to think about a lot of these different models. And I will conclude with one open problem, which I think is a great open problem, and that's this model of multiple provers. So if we take this interactive proof system model and we enhance it so that we have two provers instead of one, or we could have more than two, but let's just say we have two, and we restrict them so there's no communication between them, then it turns out that this is a very powerful model. And in the classical setting, it turns out that this model gives you exactly this class of problems, non-deterministic exponential time, which is just an enormous class of problems. It's like an exponential size version of NP. And one of the reasons, or at least intuitively speaking, one of the reasons for why you get this power is that this restriction that these two provers can't communicate really restricts the way that they can try to deceive this prover. You can sort of imagine, or this verifier rather, you can imagine this verifier is a detective. He's investigating a crime. He's trying to find the answer. He just wants the truth. And prover number one and prover number two, they're suspects in the police station. And the detective is going to interrogate them, but he's going to put them in separate rooms because he doesn't want them to talk to each other, because if they're lying, they're going to be tripped up in each other's answers because they don't know what the other person was asked and they don't know what the other person answered. So by restricting these provers not to communicate, you're really limiting their power to deceive the prover. But something happens in the quantum case which is that we have entanglement between them. And as a result of this entanglement, essentially everything we know about the classical model, which is quite a lot, suddenly flies out the window. And there's really basic fundamental questions about this model that are unanswered. If we let this class Q MIP be the class of problems we get from this model, then we end up with a class where we can't currently prove any interesting upper bounds whatsoever. In fact, we can't even show that there is a computable simulation of these things. So forget about complexity. Just think about arbitrary algorithms. We don't even know how to do that. So then my last slide is the final picture of these complexity class relations of the classes I've talked about. Here's this class QMIP up here. It would be really nice to prove some upper bounds on it. Just a couple of months ago, it was announced that this class was contained here. That's a very exciting result, but it was only an announced result, and there hasn't been a published paper yet. So that's a really exciting recent development, and hopefully it's gonna hold up. So thanks for your attention, and sorry for going over time.